Okuma kültürü ve eğitim öğretim kurumlarındaki uygulamalar Almanya örneği. Başlıklı panelimize hoş geldiniz. Geçen yılda eğitim yayıncılığı üzerine bir panelimiz olmuştu. Biz Türkiye Yayıncılar Birliği olarak okuma kültürünün geliştirilmesi ve bu konuda yapılacak her türlü çalışmayı çok önemsiyoruz. Özellikle sektör için çok önemli olduğunu düşünüyoruz. Bu konuda tabii ki tek bileşen değiliz ama bizim için en önemli konulardan biri. Almanya'da özellikle bu alanda yaptığı çalışmalarla bizim için örnek bir ülke olduğu için Almanya'dan iki değerli konuğumuz burada bulunuyor bugün. Özellikle bu panelin gerçekleşmesindeki katkılarından dolayı öncelikle Frankfurt Kitap Fuarı'na burada teşekkür etmek istiyoruz. Ve özellikle de Frankfurt Kitap Fuarı adına Sayın Claudio Dobri Schneider'e çok uğraştı hem panelistleri ayarlamak hem de maddi anlamdaki destekler için. Çok teşekkürler. Onların katkılarıyla bu paneli düzenleyebiliyoruz. Şimdi bugün iki tane konuğumuz var. Konuklarımız iki farklı alanda çalışıyor. Biri eğitim yayıncılığı alanında, diğeri de bir STK'da görevli okuma kültürüyle ilgili. Sayın Karin Plöz. Karin uzun yıllar Frankfurt Kitap Fuarı'nda sponsorluk ve işbirlikleri direktörü ve eğitim odağı direktörü olarak çalıştı. Bu görevini yerine getirirken de 2006'da başlattığı okur yazarlık kampanyası ile dünya genelinde okur yazarlık oranlarını arttırmaya yönelik projelerde bulundu ve bugün Litkem adlı kar amacı gütmeyen bir kuruluşa dönüştürdü bu çalışmalarını. Karin halen Litkem'in direktörlüğünü yürütmekte ve bize hem Litkem'in kuruluşu, Litkem'de hem okuma kültürü hem de daha dezavantajlı bölgelerdeki yaptıkları çalışmalarla ilgili bilgiler verecek. İkinci konuğumuz ise uzun yıllar eğitim yayıncılığı alanında çalışmış Sayın Doktor Anya Hagen. Sayın Hagen 20 yıl önce ders kitabı editörü olarak başlamış çalışmalarına. Ardından da 3 yıl süreyle federal hükümet ve eyalet hükümetleriyle işbirliği içinde büyük e-öğrenim projelerinin müdürlüğünü gerçekleştirmiş. 8 yılı aşkın süreyle de ilkokullara yönelik ürünlerin yayın yönetmenliğini yürütmüştür. Son olarak 5 yıl süreyle Almanya'nın en büyük eğitim yayıncılarından Franz Kornelsen'in yönetim kurulu üyeliğinde bulunmuştur. İlk ve orta öğretim pazarının tümünden sorumlu olduğu bu görevde kurumsal yalın ürün geliştirme süreçlerini oluşturmuştur. Bugün ise bağımsız danışman olarak çalışan Sayın Hagen, belediyelere, okullara ve yayıncılara dijital dönüşüm ve eğitim süreçleri konularında destek vermektedir. Hoş geldiniz öncelikle. İlk konuşmacımız Sayın Plöz. Bize Litkem'in hem kuruluş aşamasını hem bugün gerçekleştirdiği çalışmalarla ilgili bilgi verecek. Buyurun.
Hello and first thank you very much to invite me to present the projects of Litkem. Litkem was founded 2006, as she already said, the background was that we said we are in a book fair, and there are no book fairs without books. There are no books without readers, and there are no readers without literacy. So we want to spread out a little bit more literacy all over the world. It was a very high target, but then we started with a sort of literacy campaigns, and we started with the Litkem conference, an international conference in 2006, where we invited a lot of NGOs who are working with the integration and with the literacy of people. This was the first thing we do as Litkem, and in 2007 we decided to make a project of our own. It was Football Meets Culture. We grow, and then we decided to be a non-profit organization and started to be a non-profit organization 2010. what I would like to present today are three projects. So our main project is Football Meets Culture, who are dealing with literacy with books and with schools and with reading and all the things we are want to support children from neglected area. Our target group are children between 8 and 14 years. And the second is that we are also doing some conferences, education conference at the Frankfurt Book Fair, and we want to contribute a little bit to the political establishment to decide what to do to be more education equality. And that's our main goal at LitCamp. So now I will start with the first project, Football Meets Culture. I hope this will good. First, I will see you, you can see some signatures about the PISA study. You see, the best reading culture is in Singapore. They have 535 points, then Canada, then Hong Kong. Fourth is Finland, and Almania is on the 12th level, and Turkey is on the 50th level. So I think reading should be a little bit more promoted in Turkey as well as in Germany. What is relevant for reading is to be able to read and to be motivated to read. I think to be motivated to read is a very special thing. And three main factors are important to reading performance. That is the individual student and for sure the family, the teacher and the student, and the education system. And so as LitCamp, we try to combine this. We have three projects who combining schools, reading, and the children, and that are Football Meets Culture, Lesekicker, and Books Say Welcome. And now we come to Football Meets Culture. And there was also the background that we have 7.5 million individuals in Germany who cannot really read and write properly. That means they are not really illiterate, but they have problems to read a text from the meaning. And the German system has education system has another problem that the education equality is very difficult, and that there is a they don't succeed in diminishing the connection between social background and educational success. So we developed an idea. We know football motivates and supports integration. Children from all over the world, from Turkey, from Nigeria, from Great Britain and Italy, every child knows Ronaldo and desires to be able to play like him, and every child loves football, and not only boys, but also girls do this. Our long-term oriented project increases by the combination of remedial teaching, football training, and fascinating cultural events, the interest in culture, and strengthen the willingness from the children to learn. The additional motivation in our project is that the youth coaches from popular local football clubs coach the children. And our aim is to strengthen the children's self-confidence and to impart confidence for their life. So our Football Meets Culture project, we assist children from low-educated or disadvantaged families to develop their language and their social skills, and for sure their readings. And with the combination of remedial education and cultural events, the children really like a little bit more the project than to go to school. And it's an original project. And we got for our innovative pedagogical approach some prizes and was honored several times. So I will come to the concept. Sorry, I must go back. The concept is that we cooperate with a local school and a local football club. So when we are in Dortmund, we work with a school in Dortmund and we work with Borussia Dortmund. We choose 24 children from low-educated or disadvantaged families for a group, and they are aged between 8 and 12 years, and the children becomes 2 times a week, 1 hour of additional lessons and 1 hour of football trainings. They are separated in 2 groups, 12 have the lessons and 12 have the trainings, and then they changed after 1 hour. Since 2015, we also integrate digital literacy. And what we also do is that we have once a month or all 6 weeks cultural events, like a visit in a theater or in a museum. We have also mentoring and care by trained educators, and the training is done by professional youth coaches from the local Bundesliga clubs. At the moment, we have 650 children in 27 projects in 17 cities in Germany, and our highlight is the annual football tournament, where all children come together to 1 point and are two days together and plays in a tournament 1 day where they can win the Football Meets Culture Cup. What we also have, we have a cooperation with the university, the Education University of Karlsruhe, and they do an evaluation of our project, and also actually they are doing a manual where they have all the experiences of our teacher and trainers sampled and collected and worked out. And so we have a manual for all the teacher and trainers who are in our groups. So I come to the steps. Our first step is for sure the football training. The football training motivates the children at least to participate in the project. When they're new, they can play football, they say, okay, we take part. They have 2 times a week a coach from the local soccer club and trains the children. And also the coach is for sure a role model, especially the boys like the coach, and they see, oh, he's coming, and he's from Schalke 04 or from Dortmund, and they really learn what he said, and they are really punctual and are following the rules. Our second step are the additional lessons. There we work with students who are nearly a teacher and are very motivated to train the teaching with the children, but I also have a point to German learning, because we worked a lot with children with migrant background. And the classes revolve around football. For example, we would choose to work with football-related textbooks. We have a very, very popular textbook that's from Cornelsen, from our partner here on the panel, and it's the German Stars. The textbook is about football, and it's with the stars they get if the lessons are solved, and so they are more motivated to work with this book, because it's a theme they are very interested in. And then we have cultural events, and the cultural events are for the children something that they can broaden their horizon, because of many of the children we worked with are not they are not going to the museum, are not going to the theater, or are not following a reading. They are not in the cultural establishment, and not in the cultural, they are not there. So we can give them the chance to take part on this. And also we're doing workshops with them, like a rap poetry workshop, so that they can make creativity for themselves, make something, they develop a rap and a rap song, and then they have, 2 years ago, they have performed with a rap song at the Frankfurt Book Fair, so it was a very good chance for the children. They were very happy with this. The fourth step is very important. Then that's at the end of the project, the football tournament, and all the project teams take part. And what we have heard from the university, from the professor, he said that this tournament is a motivation for the children to take part the year long, and they are really eager to take part on this tournament, and it's one of their motivation to be in the project. And also, there's for many children, it's the first time they are not in their town. They are outside, and they see other children. They see other children from other places, and it's for them really effective. The effects now are. Our main objective is the long-term improvement in the children's knowledge of German, among others, and in the process to facilitate their transition to secondary school. In Germany, we have the break after the fourth classes. They have to decide in which following schools they go. And so we want to help them to have a better chance. And we have also seen that the participating children are also able to concentrate much better in their normal lessons because of sport, because of movement and of football, and that their achievement in school improves considerably. And their children's behavior with their peers and have also changed for the better. They are less aggressive and they are better in groups and they are fair. What also is that the combination of football training and the German lessons led to better language abilities of the children. When they play in a team, then they speak more often together and they learn better to articulate their intents. And the participating children feel more motivated to learn and to widen their horizons. Their social competence and teamwork skills are improved and their cultural interest is stimulated. Furthermore, they have learned in the last years the importance of a healthy lifestyle. We have every year we have a special that we are doing. So we have had healthy lifestyle like nutrition. We have had last year reading promotion, and we will have this year sustainability. And around this theme, there will be also the cultural events and the learning lessons. Now I come to the readings. What we see as motivation, especially for boys to read, is football. If the children have to read, they prefer to have books and to read maybe about football players as Ronaldo and Messi. I've seen it by myself when we go in a school and there were children, a young boy who was 9, not this boy, he was at the football, at the book fair, but in our classes, a 9-year-old boy who never read, he said he don't like to read. Then I have an article about Ronaldo, it was a long article and not so easy to read. And he sits there and read for 30 minutes to read what they stand to know more about his Ronaldo. So you see, you can motivate the children with their, if they have something they really like them. And then they started to read more books. So they must have something to start. What's always is very good is live readings. If you have an author who is really a good, maybe he must be a good reader, and the children hears about him and are in the reading, often they come and said, oh, I want to read this book. And I have a special example here. I mean, you see this boy, this was 2 months ago when they have a reading about a youth book. It was Asphalt, about some boys playing football in Berlin. And this boy who have no book of his own, it has not read, really not right to read books. He asked for the book and the author gave him his book. And then he started in the bus immediately to read this book. So you can really, reading also motivates them. And the other thing is that you have to have pictures and real stories. You must really take the children seriously. They really like to have a news magazine, and easily, it's in Germany, it's like Dein Spiegel, and with short stories, with pictures and popular themes, and then they're interested to read this, and then they started and read short stories, and after this, maybe they have one theme, they want to read a whole book about this. So we motivate the children also with this to read. And another thing, especially for boys, what we have learned is that especially boys are more eager to read on tablets or smartphones. So you cannot say, oh, don't take the smartphones or the tablets. there are also a possibility that the boys, or maybe the girls too, started to read a book because they first have a tablet and then see, oh, I want to try, and then see, oh, it's interesting, and after this, I want to read the book and not only the tablet. So that's what we are doing about reading in this project. We are here. You have a short overview about our projects. We are in several cities in Germany. Yes, 27. You see, from Frankfurt to Dresden to Düsseldorf, Köln, throughout in Germany. And we have got some prizes, some awards. What you see here, and for sure we have our ambassadors. So we have what you see, Bastian Oschipka, he is from Schalke 04. We have Ahmed Engine, football player from MSV Duisburg. We have Nia Künzer, who is a football national world champion for the women football. And we have Manuel Neuer and Dirk Nowitzki, who make a charity football match for us. And we have Joachim Kohl, who is our cultural ambassador and who is an actor. And we have Oberbürgermeister Major of Frankfurt, Peter Feldmann. This is about football meets culture. With the idea of football meets culture, we developed as LitCam also a prize for the best football book. The best football book in youth football book and a children football book. And then we have, in a jury, we have Manuel Neuer, the popular football player of in Germany, and others. And we had 10 experts in this, and 36 publishers submit their current football titles. And this year, we've started, because we had the Football World Championship, to integrate 100 schools. This is a shortlist, so you see 5 shortlist children books and 5 shortlist youth books. And then there was the decision who could be won this prize. And there we have the children who takes part, the schools, there were classes, they get the 5 books and they had 1 week to work with them and to read them and then decide. Also we do official readings in the stadiums. So we are with the shortlist, the authors of the shortlist titles, we make readings in the stadium from football stadiums, and then we choose one class who takes part in our competition to have the possibility to be on the reading in this. And then was finally the prize, and this was in the German Football Museum. And Nia Künzer, the football world champion, gives the prize to the best football children books. That was from Mario Götze, Mario's Großer Traum. And Lars Ricken, another famous Dortmund football player, he gave the book to Michael Horeni to Asphalt Fieber. And we have also, again, classes who won this to take part in this prize. You can see in this little photo, they were very happy to take part there. That was now we are coming to the last thing, at this Bücher sagen willkommen. We started Bücher sagen willkommen in 2015 together with the Börsenverein and the Frankfurter Buchmesse, and decided to learning and reading rooms in centers for refugees. And then we have sponsoring from the booksellers who makes fundings of collections. And it was before Christmas, so we get a lot of money to make this in the refugee chances. So we had at least 42 refugee centers and who have their learn and reading centers now. You see it there. And we are now starting with some schools, we have new sponsors, and we will give reading and learning centers in schools where are a lot of refugees. So that's in short all, and I thank you very much for listening.
Teşekkürler. Evet, diğer konuğumuz Sayın Doktor Anya Hagen. Kendisiyle özellikle bu uzun yıllara dayanan eğitim yayıncılığı deneyimi üzerine bize biraz işte Almanya'da okullarda kitap seçiminden bütün bu eğitim politikalarıyla birlikte yayıncıların yaptığı işbirliklerinden, desteğinden, içerik gelişimiyle ilgili yaptığı çalışmalardan söz etmesini rica ettik.
Yes, thank you very much and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the invitation. I would like to tell you something about reading culture and reading promotion in Germany. And I will also look at the way how ministries, schools, teachers, and educational publishers in Germany work together to promote reading culture. First, I have to say reading promotion is a big topic in Germany for about 18 years now. Why? It also started with the publication of the results of the first international school performance study, so-called PISA, in the year of 2000-2001. The German students performed significantly below the OECD average. The gap to the PISA winner Finland was quite substantially high. In addition, in Germany, the range between the weakest and the top performing students was highest in all OECD states. Underperformers were students from social disadvantaged families and with immigration background. Although the most German students had the technical ability to read, but they do not understand what they have read. It was a shock, totally. Germany was so proud about his educational system, which was based on the educational reforms in the 18th century. And after PISA, science, society, and economy demanded radical innovations of the educational systems. So we started a variety of initiatives, and to mention four. In Germany, you should know that we have, after primary school, we have a three-parted school system. Then you can go to lower secondary school, middle school, or grammar school. And this school system was very selective, and it offered not enough support for low-achieving students. Now, in all federal states, lower secondary schools and middle schools are increasingly closed and in favor of integrated schools in which students of all performance levels were taught together in one class with a lot of internal differentiation. And internal or individual promotion of students is a big issue, and every teacher is trained to this accordingly. In 2003, 2004, and 2012, national educational standards were published. Before that, we have no national educational standards, which put a strong focus on reading promotion. And in 2004, the National Institute of Quality Development in Education was founded in Berlin and started national comparative assessments. Since then, in every grade 3 and every grade 8 class, the students are tested and to see how this school system is working and if it is getting better and better, and if there are differences between the federal states in Germany. These efforts were successful. Since 2000, the results of German students have consistently improved in the PISA test. Not enough, as we think, but it improved. In the last PISA test, 2015, Germany was 6 points above the OECD average, and 16 points above, and 6 points better than the last PISA test. So just have a look at this ecosystem of education in Germany. In order to improve education, ministries, schools, teachers, and educational publishers have been working together in a trusting relationship for years. From the point of view of reading promotion, we should also mention European or national institutes, such as PISA Consortium, or as I mentioned, the National Institute of Quality Development. We have to mention children and teen book publishers. We have to mention NGOs like LitCam and other foundations. But in my presentation, I want to focus on these four core players. We have 16 ministries of education. You know, Germany is has 16 federal states, and we have 16 ministries of education, which means 16 curriculums, 16 school types, and something like that. But I come to this later. These ministries of education set the rules together with the supervisory school authority in the districts, and they take over the quality assurance and the quality control. That's their job, to set the rules. The 15 educational publishers in Germany offer materials and provide subject-specific, didactic, and pedagogical support for the teachers. The 33,500 general education schools in Germany implement the rules and use these materials, but in the core, in the heart of the education system in Germany are the teachers. We have 370,000 teachers in Germany. What do I mean with that they are in the heart? We in Germany believe, or the German education system is based on the freedom and responsibility of the individual teacher. Of course, he or she must comply with various laws, rules, resolutions. But however, he or she is the only one who knows the specific class, the specific students. And because of his professionalism, he knows what they need to be encouraged or to be challenged. So he is free to choose his teaching methods, and he is free to choose the learning materials and the learning or the teaching materials. So German school laws do not allow the state to dictate which materials will be used in schools. The schools and the teachers always have the educational freedom of design. Keep that in mind for everything else I will tell you. So how does this ecosystem work? In Germany, we have a functional division of tasks between the federal state and the districts, the communities, the municipalities in these federal states. The districts are the providers of the schools, and in this sense, they are responsible for the so-called external school affairs. That means they are responsible for the establishment and the maintenance of the schools, including the procurement for learning materials. The federal state ministries of education are responsible for the internal school affairs. That means they are responsible for curriculum, exam regulations, and teacher support or teacher training. The ministries of education develop the curriculum. Educational publishers create with their authors textbooks and other materials according to this curriculum and submit these unpublished textbooks to the ministries. Their reviewers check the submitted textbooks according to whether they follow the curriculum and the educational aspirations of the specific federal state. The guidelines in these federal states are different, some are less more restrictive than the others, depending on the federal state. For an example, in the curriculum of the state of North Rhine-Westphalia leaves a wide scope for publishers. You can do a lot of interpretation of the curriculum. On the other hand, in the federal state of Bavaria, even the first names of the characters in the books are predefined. So you know you have to call them Maria or Hans, or not like another name, Kevin or something like that. In best case, you as an educational publisher get the approval to publish your textbook. But ministries have other ways of working together with private educational publishers. I want to mention a specific product that works really well in Germany. In 2001, a teacher developed the platform so-called Antolin, and a few years later, this platform was sold to a private educational publisher, Westermann. Antolin is very, very popular in Germany. It is used in 90% of all German primary schools. It offers quizzes on over 70,000 children and teen books. It does not train reading skills or not the reading comprehension, but the reading motivation, as Karen mentioned, as the students can collect points and achieve high scores if they answer correctly. Antolin is exclusively sold to schools. Some federal states or districts have acquired national licenses so that schools can use Antolin without extra cost. Usually, the schools acquire a school or class license that is paid by their school budget or sponsored by booster clubs. In America, I think there are two similar portals, MyOn and RASKids, also where all quizzes about children and teen books are published. So as I said, the school laws in Germany adjust that the schools may only roll out learning materials if they have been approved by the ministries. The ministries of education publish the catalog of approved learning materials on their website. Just take a closer look at the system in the field of reading promotion. Curricula in Germany are output orientated since 2003. That means they specify what the student should be able to do at the end of a grade. However, they do not specify how this competence should be achieved. The teacher is free to design his classroom management and his teaching methods in such a way that the student builds these competencies in the best possible way. He chooses the learning tools that suits best for his learning methods and performance level of his specific class. So for an example, here on the left side, there's the curriculum of, or a few quotes out of the curriculum of the state of North Rhine-Westphalia, which determines this reading competence at the end of class 1 and 2. There it is. The students read short age-appropriate texts and answer questions about the text, and they choose from reading boxes, classrooms, or school libraries texts for their own reading. According to the Learning Resource Catalog of North Rhine-Westphalia, there are 14 different first reading books from 5 different educational publishers that are approved for this curriculum. As you can see, most educational publishers offer more than one concept, usually 3 or 4 different ones, according to this curriculum. These first reading books have different approaches. They are structured differently, offer different topics. Some offer topics like football, some offer topics like dragons, so the teacher can decide which is best for its class. And they pursue different reading learning methods. And they have different difficulty levels. That means that they are more suitable for high-performing or for low-performing classes. This diversity, this great variety of offers that emerges in this way directly benefits to the schools, the teachers, and finally the students. Market-based action always follows one principle. There's a demand and there are various offers. The customer selects the offer that suits him best. And as a provider, you are well advised to know the customer's needs very well so that your offer is selected. And you do well to please your customer so that he will choose you again at the next purchase decision. For educational media in Germany, there's no different. Through our salespeople and also through market research, teacher interviews, or sitting in on classes, educational publishers try to find out as much as possible about the needs of the schools and the teachers. Remember, educational publishers must follow the curriculum, but they can vary the concepts, learning methods, and difficulty levels. In addition, they ensure through after-sales initiatives that the learning resources can be used by every teacher and in every class. For this, they offer teacher trainings and develop supplementary material. Each of the major educational publishers offer about 1,000 training events and workshops each year for free for the teachers. Across the industry, there are between 3,000 and 4,000 teacher training events per year from educational publishers, and far more than all the state teacher trainings. As a service, because we want to sell the books. Second service thing is the supplementary material. As an example, and let us take one of these 14 first reading books from North Rhine-Westphalia, in addition to these textbooks, the educational publishers provide technical and educational background information for teachers, additional worksheets, and extra audio-visual material. There's a variety of training material for homework, but also to promote weaker students. In addition, there are materials for students with special needs or special disabilities. For example, for students also with an immigration background. And at least there are extra materials like a dictionary or an additional reading book or something like that. Supplementary material to the approved textbook is a big market in Germany. 40 to 50% of the turnover is made by supplementary material, which is not financed by the state, but by parents, teachers, or booster clubs. So, I mentioned booster clubs several times. What is it about? The school managed the budget for learning resources they receive from the districts. In addition, schools themselves have a very, very small so-called teaching budget from which they fund, for example, playing material or copy paper. If a school wants to make a special purchase, they need the support of parents or they have to collect donations. Almost every school in Germany has a so-called booster club, a booster club of the school XY. A booster club is an association of parents, teachers, alumni, local companies, very local companies, not the big companies, the local companies, the workers, craftsmen, and something like that, and committed citizens who want to support the concerns of this certain school. After the state and the parents' budget, booster clubs are the third source of fund learning materials in Germany. After the PISA shock, so-called reading corners are set up in almost every school. School libraries has always been around, but the reading corners are about drawing interest in books and improved the students' desire to read. You can see reading corners, some examples of reading corners in the pictures I put on my slide. In one corner of the classroom, there's an area for reading and chilling, equipped with comfortable furniture and a lot of books. Setting up reading corners created a market for children's and teen books beyond the normal book trade. Before the PISA shock, there were almost only fictional and non-fictional children and teen books. But in the recent years, further product groups have emerged. For example, books with different reading levels and many bilingual children and teen books for children with immigration background. Educational publishers work very closely together with teachers. And for an educational publisher, a teacher has three roles. First of all, he is the decision maker. He sets which material he wants to use in the classroom. He is a user, and he is an author. In his role as a decision maker, the teacher receives a lot of informational materials from the educational publishers sent directly to his private postal or email address. Because teachers, when they buy directly from the providers, they get 20 to 24% discount of every educational material they need for their own use. So teachers like to give their private address to the publishers. Educational publishers who have all types of schools and subjects in their portfolio have more or less 60% of all private addresses of teachers in Germany. In the role of the users, the publishers support the teacher to the maximum in the use of materials throughout supplementary materials and through teacher trainings. I mentioned that before. At the same time, Publishers are keenly interested in teacher feedback on the materials to improve their materials. The major educational publishers set up market researches, interviews, or discussion with teachers. Editors sit in on classrooms, and new concepts are pre-tested by small groups of teachers. And for digital products, there are free trial periods, especially to get the teacher's feedback. And last not least, the teacher as an author is the most important partner of educational publishers. The 15 educational publishers in Germany work together with about 30,000 authors. Most of them are teachers. And working with teachers, we believe in, guarantees that the textbooks really, really work in practice. And for the last aspect, one example in the field of reading promotion. The publishers received feedback that the children's and teen books that should be read at school were too difficult for some students. The language was too complicated, the students could not follow the story, and they did not remember what they have read. And in collaboration with teachers, educational publishers make the series so-called easy reading. And they developed a new kind of book that is, these are licensed editions of major children and teen novels, but in simplified language with supporting illustration and reading comprehension quests after each chapter, so that the children could follow the story, could get into the story, but don't have to this complicated language. So, I hope that I've been able to give you a brief overview of the German educational market and products for learning promotion. For further questions, please do not hesitate to ask me, and thank you for your attention.
Vaktimiz de az ama çok kısa bir şey sormak istiyorum. Bu ders kitaplarının ne kadarı kitapçılar aracılığıyla satılıyor? Ne kadarı direkt okula yayıncılar tarafından veriliyor? Bunu öğrenebilir miyim?
All textbooks are used in schools are made by educational publishers.
Yes, it's all right. And what percentage of those books are given directly by the publishers? And what percentage of them sold by?
You mean the sales?
The sales, yeah, the sales process, the distribution process. Okay. Actually, I'm asking for.
Okay. When a school decides that they have new textbooks, mm-hmm. Then it's said to the teacher community of this specific subject, maybe the physics teachers or so, inform yourself and then select the mm-hmm. next textbook. So the decision is made in school by the teacher community of the specific subject. And then the teacher community says, okay, hey, education publishers, come to our school or send us information materials, mm-hmm. and then they made the decision. And then they say to the district, here is our, these are the books that we want, please buy them. Mm-hmm. And so the district, somebody uh-huh. in the district, mm-hmm. Is making a call for offers, mm-hmm. Because it's European law. And most of times the local bookseller wins this competition, and then the local bookseller buys the books by the education mm-hmm, publishers, mm-hmm. and then he gives them to the schools.
But do you have any information about the percentages of those distribution? You don't. Mm-hmm.
We have no direct information. But every year we set up a call and uh-huh. call the school, say, which decision did you make? Uh-huh. Or our salesperson are in a uh-huh. very, very close contact, and they know what.
So can you make a guess about it?
I think we knew the decision in almost 50%.
Okay, thank you.
Evet,
Sorusu olan varsa alalım, buyurun. Bir şey, önce kendinizi tanıtır mısınız? Çünkü daha sonra bunları yayınlıyoruz. Bir de mikrofon, evet, pardon.
Teşekkür ederim. Ben Adem Turuncu. Ben de 2 yıl öğretmenlik yaptım da ilkokulla ilgili. Daha çok göçmenlerle ilgili bir eğitim süreciniz var. Ben daha çok buna ilgili bir soru soracağım. Peki ana dilde eğitimi siz, onunla ilgili herhangi bir eğitim veriyor musunuz çocukların gelişme için? Ve Avrupa'da da çok buna bir bilgim olmadığı için soruyorum. Avrupa'da bu iş nasıl oluyor? Ana dilde eğitim nasıl veriliyor? Onunla ilgili cevap verirseniz sevinirim. Teşekkür ederim.
You know what you mean with meta language?
Nature language.
Okay. Sorry. Yes, we have. There are some studies. They said it's the natural language. If you start, it's better. But there are often not the capabilities and there are not the possibilities to do this. And what we have learned, because we are not only working with children with migrant background, so we work with all children who have social problems or who have other things you need. So we have 70% migrant backgrounds and refugees and 30% Germans. But I think that it's better when they have one language, because when we have children with migrant backgrounds, we have very different languages. So if you have 7, 8, 9, sometimes 20 different languages in one class, then you cannot say make it with your natural language. Then we have not the capacities, not teachers, not material, and so. So that's a problem.
I want to add that some federal states, they provide lessons in the mother tongue of these children. Mostly are the very popular Turkish and Arabian, some Italian, Spain, something like that. I hope I answered your question.
Evet, başka sorusu olan? Yes, please.
Almanya'da bütün eğitim sistemi eyaletlerden kararlaştırıldığı için her eyalette değişik uygulamalar var. Mesela ben Köln'de büyüdüm ve Köln'de o zamanlar benim gençliğimde cumartesileri ekstra ders olabiliyordu. Öğretmenleriniz de ekstra ders alabiliyordunuz. Bu öğretmenler genelde Türkiye'den, Eğitim Bakanlığı'ndan gelen arkadaşlardı. Hatta benim ilkokul zamanımda, tabii bu 70'lilerde, şimdi değişmiş olabilir tamamen sistem. Ben kindergarten'a gitmediğim için Almanca ders, yani Almancam yeterli olmadığı için ilk önce Türkçe ders almıştım. İkinci sınıfın yarısında Almancamı yeterli buldular ve beni Alman sınıfına aldılar. Ve bu uygulama İtalyan, Yunan ve Türk çocukları için geçerliydi. Yeterince bu ülkelerden öğretmen vardı. Fakat bu 80'lilerde hatta 90'lılarda yeni kanunlar geldi ve kanunlara göre eyaletten eyalete farklı uygulamalar yapıldı. Mesela Frankfurt şehrinde şu anda Rus sınıfları var ve cumartesileri bu öğrenciler bütün gün sabahtan akşama kadar Rusça ders alıyorlar. Ama bunlar yedek ders olarak ebeveynler bunu karar veriyorlar. Aynısı Korelere de geçerli. Ama mesela Türkçe konusunda bir eksiklik yaşıyoruz. Çünkü Almanya'daki yaşayan ebeveynler buna çok önem vermiyorlar. Onun için ekstra, yani öğrencilerin cumartesi ya da bilmiyorum hafta sonu bir derse gitmesini sağlamıyorlar. Aksi takdirde, yani hatta tam tersi, camiye gönderiyorlar ve Arapça öğrenmesini yani bir şekilde uyguluyorlar. Hani Türkçeyi bir dil olarak çocukların öğretmeyi çok önem vermiyorlar ve hatta evde de Türkçe ve Almanca konuşuyorlar. Yani sadece bir dili konuşmayı bir şekilde önemli görmüyorlar.
Ama onların tercihi bu. Yani.
Bu onların tercihi aynen.
Yani isterlerse öğrenebilirler. Bunun
mesela
imkanları
Frankfurt'ta
var.
Frankfurt'ta halk evi var, Türk halk evi var. Onlar Türkçe dersleri sunuyorlar. Sonra uzun yıllar Diyanet DİTİB Türkçe dersleri sundu. Ama ebeveynler çocuklarını buraya yani var, tabii gönderenler de var ama bu çok azınlık yani.
Evet.
Sanırım sorunuz bu buraya ulaşıyordu değil mi?
Evet, başka soru yoksa iki konuşmacımıza da çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Gerçekten biliyorsunuz Ekim ayında Milli Eğitim Bakanlığı'nın yayınladığı bir genelgeyle Ekim'di yanlış hatırlamıyorsam. Bizde yayıncıların öğretmenlerle gidip konuşması bile yasak. Hani umarım bu tür örnekler özellikle PISA sonuçlarında kötü not alıp daha sonra bir devlet olarak, ulus olarak alarma geçip işte yayıncılarla işbirliği yapıp daha sonra ülkelerindeki eğitim seviyesini çok iyi bir yere getiren bir ülke örneği bizim için de ilham verici olabilir. Biz bu panelin de yine bütünüyle hem sosyal medyada yayınlayacağız, videosuna ulaşabileceksiniz hem de kitapçık olarak dağıtacağız. İlgililerin de böyle bir örneği değerlendirmesini umut ediyoruz. Yayıncıların da içerik geliştirme konusunda ne kadar hevesli olabileceğini, yani Anya'nın da sonunda söz ettiği gibi öğretmenlere eğitim veren bir yere gelmiş durumda bugün Almanya'daki ders kitabı, yardımcı ders kitabı yayıncıları. Bizde ise ders kitabını devlet üretiyor, ürettiriyor. Yardımcı ders kitabının zaten gerek olmadığını artık iddia ediyorlar ve bunu piyasadan kaldıracaklarını. Ama Anya'nın sunumunda da gördüğümüz gibi orada bile %30, %40 seviyesinde yanlış hatırlamıyorsam bir yardımcı ders kitabı pazarı var. Ne olursa olsun umarım bizler için iyi bir örnek olacaktır. Yine okuma kültürüyle ilgili futbol örneği için çok teşekkür ediyoruz. Umarım biz de böyle çok farklı kitap okumayı özellikle erkek çocuklar gibi bu konuda çok isteksiz olan ve zorlamaya ihtiyaç duyan gruplara sevdirmek için benzer projeler yapabiliriz. Çok teşekkür ediyorum katıldığınız için.